it stands for, as well as our freedom and all those who serve to protect it. Please rise for the playing of our national anthem.
Welcome to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and welcome to the Dome at Valley Fields, as today we have a non-conference contest for Marquette men's lacrosse as the Drexel Dragons come to town for this Saturday contest. Alongside my partner Eric Simon, I'm Dan Avington. Eric, Marquette will be challenged today by a Drexel team that was great last season, but is a bit depleted today.
That's right. Marquette has the will and the energy to be a very successful team. Today they try to put together the pieces of those puzzle with some new pieces, some new players.
For the Golden Eagles, Bobby O'Grady has provided the offensive firepower so far this year, including four goals in Marquette's win over Detroit Mercy on Saturday.
He continues to be the spark for this team. His teammates are going to look to get him the ball when he's near the crease.
Last week's Big East Freshman of the Week has a powerful inside presence and a hard outside shot, and the Golden Eagles will be looking to get the ball to number 13 as much as they possibly can today. Meanwhile, for the Drexel Dragons, midfielder Jack Mulcahy will rarely come off the field, especially after a 9-point output against St. Joe's this week.
Well, the Marquette coach Stimmel described his respect for this Drexel program, and it's filled with selfless leaders like Jack Mulcahy.
We are all set to go here from the seasonal bubble at Valley Fields. Marquette and Drexel both looking to extend winning streaks here on this Saturday afternoon. The Dragons fresh off a weekday victory over St. Joe's earlier this week, an 18-17 thriller to move their record above 500 on the year. And Marquette looking to build upon a win over Detroit Mercy on Saturday. One big storyline for today, both of these teams injury ravaged, Eric. Marquette's offense, we'll be running with some players that they haven't seen so far this year, and Drexel's defense is missing some crucial contributors.
And both have great leadership in their coaches, and they've built a culture that allows anyone to step up on any given day, and we hope to see that here today.
In the cage today for Drexel is redshirt freshman Drew McGill, who has 19 saves on the year in three games with his first career start coming on Tuesday against St. Joseph's. Ross Blumenthal, the normal goalie, out with an injury for this afternoon. Both teams head out to midfield, and now we'll take a look at Marquette's netminder, Michael Alieri, the redshirt freshman out of Massachusetts. Five starts on the year, 49 saves for a 48% save percentage, 53 goals allowed on the year. Marquette wearing the white jerseys, Drexel in the all-navy kits today. Luke Williams and Liam Rosato out there for the faceoff. Marquette surprisingly might have the faceoff edge in this one, which is not something that they've had all that often in recent years.
And Coach Stimmel said it. He said if they don't get it cleanly, they're going to try to make it a battle.
And Luke Williams wins the first one to himself, and Marquette will start on offense. Williams carries to the other side, now moves it up to Bobby O'Grady.
The key for the Marquette offense here is to get some shots on goal early. They took a lot of shots in the last game, but they weren't on goals. So they didn't test the goalie.
O'Grady, Stegman, and Will Foster are the three attackmen. Pierce Washburn, Griffin Freeze, and Chris Kirshner, the starting offensive midfield. Washburn, sophomore out of Maryland, moves the ball up top. Foster now to Kirshner. George Grippo defending, one of the best short stick D-mids in the country.
Good ball movement so far by the Marquette offense.
Kirshner back to Stegman at X, Marquette's quarterback. Stegman comes around, now reassesses, gives way to Kirshner.
They're doing a good job of keeping the ball moving but still being dangerous as attackers with the ball on their stick.
20 seconds remain on the shot clock as Griffin Freeze initiates from up top. The left-handed rip goes wide. Kirshner is there for the backup. Exactly 15 seconds on the shot clock. Not a bad first opportunity for Marquette.
Well, they're attacking from all angles, and that's a really good dynamic look.
Here's Kirshner. Fires a shot high. left-handed. 9 seconds left on the shot clock. Still enough time for a good look. 13:46 on the game clock. Marquette bleeding this first possession down against a veteran Drexel defense. Foster initiates. 4 seconds. Foster going towards the net, and he won't get it off. And Drexel wants a flag for a delay of game, but they won't get it. Shot clock violation on Marquette's first possession.
Marquette sets up their ride outside the box here, lets the goalie come up a little bit.
Zach Chenard, one of the star midfielders for this Drexel team, makes his way onto the field. Mulcahy, who we talked about in the open, also makes his way onto the field. Tristan Plotz joins them in the starting lineup today. Joseph guarding Mulcahy. Gets a step, now the feed, and Max Semple finishes it off. A bit too easy there for the Drexel offense.
Well, Drexel did a good job of kind of drawing the Marquette defense out to make that little undercut there by the crease.
Max Semple, the transfer from Jacksonville, has been a revelation for this Drexel offense early this season. Now in his fifth start, this is his 11th goal of the year. Redshirt freshman out of Coquitlam, Canada. Rosado heads back out for the faceoff against Williams, and Lou Will wins this one to himself. He's got a step, now gives it back to Mason Woodward. The long pole shot, save made, Drew McGill. That's a huge save, and Marquette's backup is not there.
Well, it was on goal, and a nice big hard shot from the long pole. But you got to back that one up.
Tough one to see if you're a goalie, as Jacob Hallam intercepts the feed from McGill. Now Aaron Joseph carries it over.
Nice job by the Marquette ride there, hanging back and picking off that pass.
Freshman mistake there from Drew McGill, the goalie. Tried to move too quick. Marquette's second midfield comes on. Hayden Miller, Ellison, Burt Murray, and Luke Blanc. As Miller goes inside, and he scores! Hayden Miller, using his speed to his advantage, moves around the defender and easily finishes one off.
One of those classic examples of Marquette offense trying to change up the tempo. They're trying to shoot when you think they're not ready to. Really well done. Little S dodge.
One one is the score, 12:09 up on the clock. A bit more of a lockup this time, but Luke Williams gets it to himself. Williams, the feed to O'Grady, quick shot, and a goal for Bobby O'Grady.
Marquette's taking advantage of that face-off advantage they have right now, right? Getting the momentum going on their side.
Luke Williams, 3-for-3 at the X. And we'll take a look at the faceoff right here as he wins it to himself. Nobody around him. Right over to the freshman O'Grady. And he goes low. No chance for Drew McGill on that one.
Real nice bounce shot. And that's the kind of shots you got to take in early on in the game.
2-1 Marquette leads. Somebody went early. It was Williams. So that'll be a faceoff win for Anthony Rosado, the brother of Liam.
That's right, and that's Drexel's first faceoff win here.
And they'll get a settled offensive set. Mulcahy draws the pole. Quick dodge already. Logan Crines bumps him down to the ground. Pass was deflected, so Drexel will maintain possession. Our first true look at the Drexel offense in a settled set. Sean Donnelly, Aiden Call, and Max Semple, the three attackmen. Jack Mulcahy and Ryan Genord will be the regular midfielders, and then we'll see a little bit of a mix in that third spot. Tristan Plotz has seen time already. As Genord looks for a feed inside, Call can't handle it, and Anthony Corsell scoops up the loose ball. And an errant pass from Marquette there. Not a great decision on the clear.
That's a tough one. That's a risky pass.
Crines hounding Mulcahy. But Drexel has an offensive possession again after their turnover.
Crines has a significant height advantage over Mulcahy, so he's going to have to get low in order to apply equal pressure on him.
Luke Stansfield comes on as Janord will head off. Here's Mulcahy looking for Donnelly, who has the short stick matchup, and Anthony Corsell. Sean Donnelly feeds inside. Now another pass. Michael Alieri makes the first save of the day for the Golden Eagles.
Really well done. Didn't buy any of the fakes. That's a great save.
Great save going down low as Corsell draws a flag. Drexel not happy with that call. I don't think I would be either if I was them.
Yeah, that's tough in the middle of the field there.
Bit of a free possession here for Marquette. Chris Kirshner joined by the rest of the first midfield. Kirshner with a good output last time against Drexel, a hat trick back in 2019, his true freshman season. In that game, Jake Stegman put forth 2 goals and 4 assists, one shy of a Marquette record in that game.
Marquette attackers trying to attack a short pole here. Drexel keeps switching the long pole onto him.
O'Grady has a short stick, trying to initiate. Grippo gets that ball loose, but O'Grady gets it back. He's open, missed the shot. Coming right across, but Marquette will go man up. Good look there for O'Grady, but is playing with house money a little bit. So Sean Donnelly will go to the box, push with possession. And Marquette's man up unit will come out. That'll be Luke Blanc, Holden Patterson, and Pierce Washburn out there along with the 3 starting attackmen.
So far, Marquette offense, team offense, doing a really good job of moving the ball. They should hit the ground running here in their first man up opportunity.
Likely to see everybody get a touch here around the perimeter.
Only one on the crease for Marquette right now. Second person cuts on.
Washburn, a big shot from outside. Save made on the bouncer. Loose ball being scrapped for. Big GB there from Jake Stegman to maintain the possession. 7 seconds on the clock. Holden Patterson rips one. It's blocked. Now Drexel in transition. That's Sean Quinn facilitating. Donnelly, the Semple. Save made again by Alieri. LaMarca barely keeps that one in bounds. Drexel almost able to take advantage of some transition play, but Alieri robs them.
He's starting this game pretty hot. I'm sure he's inspiring his defense too.
Washburn triple teamed, puts his shoulder down and gets over midfield. As Peter Rahill couldn't handle the heat. Marquette will settle again. Ellison Burt Murray wearing number 9 today in place of his usual 0. Foster, now to Miller. Aiden Miller, Marquette's first goal today. Good ball movement here for the Golden Eagles.
Attacking from all corners.
Luke Blanc, the UMass transfer. Miller's open, shot, save made again by McGill. Shot clock resets. And a nice play there by McGill to take the ball out of midair and avoid any rebound opportunity.
Yeah, his height really helped there, right? Scooped it with his feet still in the crease.
McGill in his second start today, as we mentioned. Ross Blumenthal out. Moe Lardy out there guarding Mulcahy.
Now Drexel looks to initiate with a short pole defender.
Janord picks up the ground ball. He's defended by Aaron Joseph. Joseph bodies him off. Aaron Joseph doesn't normally have a size advantage, but today when he's guarding Janord, he will.
That's right.
Great defense there from the lefty, Noah Verlinde. Forces a bad shot from Donnelly. But the backup is there.
Really good job of getting your sticks in the mix there by the Marquette defense.
Semple. Feed. Donnelly is there, and he converts. A bit of a broken play there. And a little bit of pushing and shoving afterward as Verlinde tosses hands up, but Drexel is able to finish as that pass barely made it through some Marquette long sticks. We'll see it on this replay. Semple just tosses one over, and Donnelly able to finish it off.
You can see that Drexel's pretty comfortable initiating from the wing and from X behind so far. Marquette's going to have to clean up those passing lanes.
Williams wins another one to himself after the violation on the last one, the only reason why Drexel got there first. Both faceoff men still out there. Marquette keeping their poles in the offensive zone. Now Crines heads off, as will Mason Woodward. Williams looking to go. A slide comes, and it's a takeaway for Drexel. Maybe not the best choice there by Williams.
Yeah, I mean, it was a good idea, but they were still getting substitutions on, so they didn't have a full squad out there.
So now Drexel comes ahead with a tie game, 2-2. Dan Addington and Eric Simon on the call here from a chilly Valley Fields dome.
Again, initiating, attacking a short stick defender.
Kirshner out there defending right now. Plots, looking, gets a step, and the shot goes wide. They're calling a play, it seems, for Sean Curcio. 52, who has the rock right now. Defended by Kirshner. Marquette looking to be early to slide here as Aiden Call winds up and beats Alieri far side. Heck of a shot there from Aiden Call.
Drexel has identified, they love starting attacking a short stick right there, right? They get their eyes up, get more room to make that feed.
Not sure if Kirshner was caught on defense or if Marquette's trying to move him to a two-way player, but normally an offensive midfielder. Bit of a mismatch there.
Right, and the Drexel coaching staff identified that right away.
Williams went early. That's his second violation of the day.
So far, it's only him who can beat himself at the face-off X.
Drexel with the lead here as Ronnie Gunter comes on for the first time. He'll attack Joseph, dodging downhill, and a save made by Alieri. Saw that one all the way. Mason Woodward picks up the ground ball. Now flips Fields for the clear. Alieri moving his way up the field. Pass to Freeze, and he's got him.
The Marquette clears have been a little unsettled so far, but they've getting the job done.
Washburn heading to the right. Now to Foster at X. Foster.
Nice skip pass. Hangs the defense player above the crease here. He's got some time and space to look to feed.
Patrick Yudovich, the physical defender. Takes Marquette's biggest attackman as Foster goes to the cage and he scores. The bouncer goes for number 22. And we've got a 3-3 ball game.
Really nice job by the team defense. Again, they're changing up the tempo.
Foster drew a short stick on his dodge from X, able to take advantage.
The big bouncers are working real well for Marquette offense so far.
That was Charlie Malley who got beat. Normally a long pole, but with Drexel's injuries today to Brent McVicker, Lucas Snyder, among others, Malley has had to pick up a short stick.
A lot of players adapting for both squads here.
Rosado wins this one. Anthony Rosado, that is, not his brother Liam. Thomas Washington took that faceoff for the Golden Eagles. Washington last time against Drexel went 17 of 26 with 12 ground balls, his career high. No success on the first one, though. Here comes Tristan Plotz downhill. 3:40 up on the clock in the first quarter. Janord, Plotz, now over to O'Donnell.
Marquette defense showing a different look here. This might be like more of a zone look.
Janord dodging against Hallam. He's got a step. That's got to be a hold. And it's a goal, too. Wow.
Nice job finishing on that one.
Not sure how he got that one off. The flag will be waved off.
Really good stick protection, huh?
Hallam was... Not sure if you could hear it there from the referee, but 30-second hold waved off as Hallam simply wrapped his arm around. But Janord still able to get right to the crease and convert.
Yeah, the help was a little late there. He got too close to the goal before he was able to shoot.
Janord, a 5'8 graduate student. All-American honorable mention last year as Thomas Washington wins the clamp. Now the ground ball comes. It looks like Marquette went early. Actually, it's a loose ball push.
I saw what you saw, too. You're not allowed to release from that line until there's a possession, but the push happened before, I think.
So Marquette mix and matching a little bit here. That's Luke Blanc, Ellison Burt Murray, and Chris Kirshner are this midfield line. Burt Murray back to X. Here's Blanc. Working on Maley. Physical dodge, he goes in and he scores. Luke Blanc takes it to the rack.
You got to give the Marquette offense credit. They can really initiate this team offense with anyone, right?
Maley once again gets beat, this time by the physical play of Luke Blanc. Blanc, the number 48 recruit in the class of 2020, went to UMass initially, didn't play at all for the Minutemen.
And finishes up high. So they're really placing their shots all around the goal, which is great.
This Marquette team capable of getting goals from a lot of different players, as we've seen today. Washington tries to feed it to O'Grady, and a big pickoff there for Sean Quinn.
Yeah, great stick to pick that out of the air.
Quinn, a senior captain out of Summit, New Jersey. First team all CAA last year. Preseason media All-American, according to Inside Lacrosse. As that ground ball finds its way over to Donnelly, and Drexel will set up with their offensive personnel. First midfield line headed out there. Moe Lardy, Aaron Joseph, and Anthony Corsell will be Marquette's defensive rope unit.
Drexel's offense is a little more deliberate to get set up, but now they look like they're ready to initiate.
Marquette in the zone right now. And it works out as Moe Lardy picks up the ground ball. Anthony Corsell has a step. Corsell, pump fake, now dishes, and Stegman converts. Marquette in transition again, and Jake Stegman fires one past McGill.
Even their fast break has that tempo change. The fake and then the shot, really well done.
The coaching staff has called Anthony Corsell one of the best athletes on the lacrosse field, and you could see it there. Not only an athlete, but has the IQ. Able to give it up to Stegman. And a low rip.
The bounce shots are working really well for Marquette.
1 minute slash against Janord. We will still have the faceoff, though, after the goal.
You'll see a Drexel wing person missing. We'll have to face off with two.
Williams gets this to himself. Now flips it to Stegman, and Marquette will bring on their man-up unit. Drexel this season has unfortunately had to get used to a lack of face-off success after the graduation of Jimmy Koida. They've had to use six different face-off men this year, and before the game, Coach Volker was talking about how they have a Thunderdome style to decide who the three will be that go the next day.
Yeah, and it makes it really tough to get a momentum going when you score a goal, but then you give back the next faceoff. So that's a real important part of their game.
Marquette almost coughed up the ball, but able to maintain. 13 seconds. Patterson to Washburn. O'Grady, a lefty rip, and he's got it.
Bobby O'Grady, the man up goal, gives Marquette a 6-4 advantage.
That's his spot today, that right wing bounce shot. He loves it so far.
A high scoring game for two teams that pride themselves on their defensive effort. A veteran Drexel D unit. They're a bit thin today. And Bobby O'Grady able to sting one past McGill. A two-goal advantage for Marquette with 58 seconds remaining and in quarter one.
Yeah, credit to both offenses for executing. They really, the attention to detail is excellent.
Williams and Anthony Rosato out there. Williams pops one up, and he will have it. Luke Williams dominant on the faceoffs today. That's now 8-11 for Marquette. Two wins for Drexel have come off violations by Williams, and Washington also lost the first one he took.
The Drexel defense is pressing out a little bit here with only 30 seconds left in the period.
Looks like Marquette wants to isolate George Grippo here. Kirshner will try to take advantage of the short stick. Marquette said Cowboy with 15, which typically means they're going to go. And the ball gets taken away. Drexel will try to take advantage. Alieri content to run out that clock. Good GB there from Marquette's netminder. And that will do it for the first quarter. 6-4 Marquette leads after 15 minutes of action. We're going to take a break here on this broadcast, but when we come back, the second quarter between Marquette and Drexel.
We're different here. We don't just get up for another day. We rise. We don't just work. We endeavor. We're women and men, for and with others. We have hope. We believe. And we celebrate. Why are we different?
So we can be the difference.
Lacrosse fans, bring your group to a market game this season. Groups of 15 or more can purchase tickets for just $2 each. Call 414-288-GO-MU to book your group experience today. Marquette Athletics would like to thank its champion level partners for their continued support, including Advocate Aurora Sports Health, Meyer, Pepsi, and Townbank. All right, Marquette fans, it's Saturday morning, and that means it's Marquette Lacrosse Karaoke time. Let's hear you sing along with some Townbenders.
Welcome back to Valley Fields. One quarter down, Marquette leads 6-4 over the Drexel Dragons. We'll take a look at the final few goals of that first as Ryan Genord took advantage of the short stick matchup, but then it was all Marquette from there on out, Eric.
Yeah, they're executing really well. Their shot placement is excellent.
Luke Blanc took that one, then Marquette in transition. Corsell to Stegman. Pretty easy goal for the Golden Eagles, who say that they're dangerous as soon as they cross midfield. And here we get a look at the man-up tally for Bobby O'Grady. And that is how Marquette is up 6-4 after 15 minutes of action. Both teams headed back out for the face-off. Marquette will head left to right during this period. Drexel the opposite, of course. This one a lock-up. Nice ground ball for Jack Farrell. An important face-off win for Drexel, who needed to regain some momentum. Marquette double poles on face-offs, too. So the fact that a wing picks up the ground ball,
yeah,
all the more impressive.
Yeah, that's right. And you can see how hard it was for them to win that faceoff. And that's what they're going to need to do if they're going to stay in this game.
Drexel subs on some offense personnel. Charles Dumas joins Janord and Mulcahy. Marquette in a zone once again. Defensive coordinator Jake Richard alternating between man and zone today. Dumas for Janord. Mason Woodward marking him. Dumas surveying, now gives way. Aiden Call in the middle, not really on the crease. But trying to flash around. Anthony Corsell on him. Semple was open, but Corsell covers up. 15 on the shot clock. The zone's doing its job so far as Mulcahy can't convert. Back up, not there for Drexel. Good dodge by Mulcahy, but can't finish with some sticks in his face.
Yeah, that zone seems to be clogging up the crease really well for Marquette defense.
Marquette on offense now. Cole Sprinkle, the LSM for Drexel at the moment.
Like you said, they're dangerous as soon as they step over midfield.
Washburn trying to go against the short stick. Maley now draws the slide. Quinn hounding him. O'Grady has a short stick matchup as well. Might try to take advantage. Here's Maley. O'Grady has a step shot. No save. Actually, there was a save. They're going to reset the shot clock to 60.
So you got a little piece of that.
Looks like it was clean, but the referee is obviously right there. And they give Marquette a fresh 60. No 80-second resets this year. Tough pass there for Foster. He picks up the ground ball, heads inside. Save made by McGill. Marquette will have to scramble back in order to prevent some transition as Brendan Greenwald will facilitate the clear. And a pretty easy clear for Drexel. Calm, patient, and they found Mulcahy.
That's right. When they spread out and let the ball do the work, let the passes do the work, it's pretty easy to clear the ball.
Marquette back in the zone. Kirshner is in the middle. Janord. Now for Donnelly. Stansfield looking inside. Hallam is there. He gets wrapped up. Ooh, great dodge there from Jacob Hallam in the open field. Moe Lardy coming down the long pole shot. Bounces wide. Will Foster is there for the backup. Good look, though, for Moe Lardy in transition.
Yeah, Drexel has yet to figure out that Marquette zone. And Marquette's doing a great job of having their sticks up in those passing lanes.
Hayden Miller, who's got a goal today. Blanc. He's going. The shot, bouncer. Looked like that one caught the shaft of McGill. Ground ball picked up by Miller. It looked like he fired a shot. No push called. Marquette has the ground ball. O'Grady will take it out and reset. Probably could have been a push there by Marquette, but no call.
Nice hustle, nice team ground ball there to keep this possession.
O'Grady working on Grippo. Bobby O'Grady. Man, oh man. Tough dodge against the short stick, George Grippo, and he somehow finishes.
With the slightest of angle, right on the wing there. Really well done.
Bobby O'Grady making us look good with a hat trick so far. Oh boy. No angle at all. It looked like McGill had sealed the near pipe, but able to go five hole. A hat trick already for the freshman out of Milton, Massachusetts. He has certainly been impressive early in his Marquette career, and he will be someone to watch out for over the next four seasons. As Thomas Washington wins this to himself, it's a 7-4 Marquette advantage. Thomas Washington sprinting off after a nice face-off win.
The face-off unit's definitely doing their job, keeping momentum on the Marquette side.
Kirshner trying to initiate against Maley. Now ahead for Washburn. He's got Peter Rahill. Washburn coming downhill. Now he looks back to X. Stegman up top. O'Grady fires one wide. The backup is there. He got crushed there between two defenders, Yudovich and Brennan Greenwald.
That's an aggressive Drexel defense we hear so much about.
Kirshner going on Maley. Oh, he slips and falls, but he still has possession. Check comes in, and Sprinkle makes a nice play on the pass coming across. Now Drexel will initiate their clear.
Both teams doing a great job of getting their sticks up in passing lanes.
Sprinkle carries across. The second pole for this Drexel unit. And they turn it over. Right back to Marquette goes the ball. Coach Volker not happy about that one. After you finally get a big defensive stop. That's the clear that you need.
That's right. Drexel's having a little harder time settling into an offensive set than Marquette. That plus the face-off advantage for Marquette means they're going to have more possession time.
Here's Jake Stegman working from X. Marquette now has their full offense on there. Washburn coming. Takes a heavy check. And Marquette will take a timeout. First timeout we've gotten today. And the Golden Eagles lead 7-4, 8:40 remaining in quarter number two. Marquette fans, Baird is proud to support Marquette Athletics through their sponsorship of the Student Athlete of the Month, recognizing students who excel on and off the field. Men's distance runner Patrick Burns is the Baird Blue and Gold Fund Student Athlete of the Month for March. He graduated cum laude in December, majoring in data science with a minor in information systems, and he is currently pursuing his master's in data science, specializing in machine learning. Patrick is a three-time All-Big East academic team member. Congratulations, Patrick Burns, Baird Student Athlete of the Month. Marquette Athletics would like to thank our champion-level partners, Advocate Aurora Sports Health, Meyer, Pepsi, and Town Bank. We are Marquette. So if you look at pretty much any statistical column so far, it's the Golden Eagles leading the way. Shots, Marquette is 20 compared to just 10 for Drexel. Golden Eagles are 1-for-2 on the man up, while Drexel hasn't gotten an extra man opportunity at all. Ground balls, Marquette leading 2-1, 20-10 so far in ground balls. 9-for-13, Marquette is on faceoffs, 5 caused turnovers by the Golden Eagles. So far, all the stats that matter are going Marquette's way, Eric.
Right, and you see it from all over the field. They're taking care of the ball. They have a little bit of more confidence on offense as well. They're getting their sticks up in passing lanes on defense, so really well done so far.
These two teams have only met once before, a 13-11 Drexel victory back in 2019. Stegman had a 6-point game in that day thanks to 2 goals and 4 assists, like I mentioned earlier, while Kirshner totaled a hat trick as a true freshman for Marquette. Still two of the most important Marquette offensive members, especially with no Devin Cowan, no Russell Melendez, no Nolan Rappas. For this Marquette attack unit, you could really fill an entire starting attack with Marquette's injuries as a early turnover is caused.
Really nice check there.
Maley comes and it's picked off. Woodward picks up the ground ball. And now Marquette will spark transition the other way. Aiden Call on defense. Marquette may try to trap him.
There's a flag down. It might be offside.
It's definitely offside. Drexel only has 2 players in the offensive zone right now. They might have. No, I guess not 2 extra, but you can see all the Navy bodies out there.
Yeah.
So they'll have a floater here. Foster comes, and he's not able to hit his mark. But Marquette will go man up again, their third time on the extra man today. It was a good attempt by Aiden Call to try to get back on defense and prevent transition, but nobody else knew that he was coming. So the attackman goes back, the midfielders all go back, and that's four guys crossing the midfield line.
All right, that's right. Yeah, that's one of the hardest places to communicate in the open field, telling someone to stay back so you can go over, trying to prevent a fast break there.
I think Coach Volker arguing that Marquette was also offsides, maybe too many men coming out of the box, but.
Yeah, that was a tumultuous transition for
sure. That's for sure. Marquette works it around the perimeter. Here's Holden Patterson, redshirt junior from Virginia.
Credit to the Drexel defense here. They're pressing out a little bit.
Blanc to Stegman. And Drexel is back to full strength. Marquette almost had an easy chance. They're going to rule the pass was tipped, though. Oh, never mind. No tip. Looked like Marquette was saying tip, and Patterson didn't really pursue it.
And now the refs are going to talk it over.
The Marquette sideline was clearly signaling for a tip, and Patterson clearly thought so as well, as he didn't give it a full sprint to the corner. They're going to ask the judge on the far side. And it's still Drexel ball. So Marquette now 1-for-3 on the EMO. Extra man opportunity. And Drexel will look to clear. Marquette yelling Cujo, which is clearly the sign for their zone defense.
That's right. A really important offensive possession here for Drexel. They need to get some rhythm.
Here's Zach Augustine up top. Logan Krines on him. Drexel, a lot of players out on the perimeter right now. Now two inside. Cutter in Call. Augustine. Marquette. Moving well. Oh, good double. Ball is poked loose. Ground ball picked up by Mulcahy. Unsettled. Ooh, shot barely goes high. I thought that one was going far down. But yeah, Marquette has the backup.
He had a good screen on that shot. That's a good opportunity.
Aaron Joseph, one man clear. O'Grady's open. Marquette will settle a little bit, though. They'll get Joseph off. Griffin Fries will enter. Anthony Corsell back to the midline as well.
Another good slow break transition for Marquette offense. They looked dangerous that whole time. They ended up pulling it out and being more patient, but they could have taken a couple of those opportunities.
Chris Kirshner back at X, working on Rahill. Draws a slide. Brennan Greenwald now defending, senior captain. Fries to Hayden Miller. Miller goes right, now to X. O'Grady gets a step, switches hands. Ooh, almost had a right hand, almost a backhanded shot there. Doesn't go.
Some fancy stick work.
10 seconds on the shot clock. Miller gets knocked to the turf. 6 seconds. Marquette will have to go soon. Kirshner just fires one to the corner. They'll take the shot clock violation and get their defensive personnel on. Probably not the worst decision for Marquette, who currently leads by 3.
That's right. They're leading in time of possession, so might as well get a nice ride here.
McGill moving forward. Ooh, almost a bad pass, but Rahill is there for the backup. That was a close one.
Yeah, good awareness in the middle of the field there.
Max Krzyzewski along with Jacob Hallam, the short sticks for Marquette. Logan Krines at the point of the defense here. Eric, what's the difference as a defender for playing zone versus man?
Well, zone, you hope to move less and talk more, right? Sticks up in the passing lane like everything else. But the idea is that you move as a unit instead of individually man-to-man.
Simple from the outside. Oh, boy. A laser comes from Max Semple. First goal of the quarter for Drexel, and now it's 7-5 on the outside rip from the Canadian. Probably a screen there on Alieri. He didn't see that one any of the way.
Yeah, maybe multiple screens. So a good goal for Drexel, but I don't think they've really figured out the Marquette zone yet.
Washington out there again. Our first faceoff in a few minutes. He and Anthony Rosato, who will take the draw. And Rosato went early. It'll be Marquette ball.
The struggles continue for the Drexel faceoff units.
Will Foster, freshman out of Eden Prairie, Minnesota. Marquette gets it up to their midfield unit. Ellison Burt Murray, sophomore out of Atlanta, product of the IMG Academy. Washburn working on Grippo, left-handed shot, no good. Marquette has three players on the backup there.
They're not going to make that mistake today.
Not a bad look for Washburn, who Stimmel talked about as exploding onto the scene this year. Consistent, that was the word Stimmel used to describe him, as Stegman tried to feed one right in front, and the pass does not get there. Marquette gets all the defensive guys on. Easy pass to Janord, who's got a step. Corsell able to recover in time. 2:55 to go in half number one. Marquette's defense scrambling a little bit here, and it looks like they will finally settle some things down. Mulcahy for Janord. Those two players rarely come off the field when Drexel's on offense. Oh, a big shot from Ryan Janord. Went low to high, and he beats Alieri. It's a one-goal game.
A little confusion by the Marquette defense there. They didn't step out on him. So that's another part of the zone, is sometimes you get caught sitting inside and looking for an outside shot.
7-6 is our score.
So maybe that's the key to Drexel beating the zone, is the outside shot, well placed with a screen, maybe a fake.
Washington able to win it on the ground ball. Marquette gets an 80-second shot clock. O'Grady thought about going early, but reassesses.
They're always dangerous. That's what makes Marquette offense really good.
Kirshner trying to work on Curcio. Foster somehow able to keep that one, and a flag comes. .145 up there on the clock, as Jake Stegman will try to work on Quinn. Washburn from goal line extended. Freeze. Marquette trying to get everybody some touches. Kirshner going left, he scores! Chris Kirshner stings the corner. Big momentum shift there for Marquette. After Drexel had the last two, Kirshner goes top shelf.
Yeah, really great job. They're patient, but they're attacking from all corners. You never know where they're gonna come next.
You can see him take on Sean Curcio there. A pretty shot going left. And Marquette will go man up, as 29 Patrick Yudovich will head to the box. For a minute, I believe it was a slash call. With 1:18 to go, Marquette leads 8-6. We'll take another look at this goal from Kirshner. Pretty much took that one himself. And McGill, a righty, he can't get that high that fast.
Right. Both sides, the shooters are dialed in. The placements are fantastic.
From the biggest of games to the ones that mean the most to us, whenever you mire, you support hundreds of local sports teams across the Midwest. Gruber Law Offices are proud to support Marquette University Athletics. Gruber Law, one call, that's all. So this Drexel and this Marquette team, both a little bit injury ravaged today. Drexel's defense is really the one, the unit that they're missing out on. Brent McVicker and Lucas Snyder, two of their important short sticks, not able to play today. Mm-hmm. Ross Blumenthal, their normal netminder, is out. So it's McGill who's in there. Casey Waller, a normal starting offensive midfielder, has missed a few games in addition. But for Marquette, it's pretty much the same thing, just on the offensive end. I talked about earlier, you could fill a whole attack unit with the Marquette players that are out. Nolan Rappas, who was already filling in for Devin Cowan and Russell Melendez, went down against UDM. Cowan and Melendez are out indefinitely. Zach Granger, a starting defenseman, is out for a few weeks. Garrett Moya and Jordan Schmid, two senior captains who are expected to have a role on this team, have been out the whole year. So this is a Marquette team that is already missing out on some players. The Rappas injury didn't help things, but their offense actually looks more potent than ever today.
Yeah, and this is when you rely on your culture. You hope that day in and day out at practice, everyone's going game speed. They can step into these situations and have success.
Marquette gets the timeout. Whew. Drexel's not happy. And I don't know that I blame them. Didn't look like full possession for T-Wash. But they give it to him, and Marquette able to take the timeout, and they will have pretty much the entire clock to bleed down if they want.
That's right. And, you know, it shows the importance that Marquette puts on the faceoff, right? All these little details, scooping that ball up and calling timeout, even the coaches are invested in getting every faceoff that they can.
So Thomas Washington is now 6-for-7 on his draws, and Luke Williams is 6-for-9, two of those, by the way, on violations. That's 11 combined ground balls for the two faceoff men. And for Marquette, the faceoff unit has been a major point of emphasis in the past few years. They haven't been as strong, and that means that they've needed their defense to get some takeaways, and they needed their offense to convert pretty much every time. But this year, Luke Williams, who the team calls Lou Will, and Thomas Washington, they have been spectacular for the Golden Eagles, and it's almost a complete swap of where these teams were a year ago, because Jimmy Coida for Drexel was one of the best in the country, and Marquette couldn't win a ton of faceoffs, and now completely flipped.
Right, and, you know, another key to Marquette faceoffs is, like, if they're not winning it clean and getting a fast break off it, they're making a battle out of it. So you're at least allowing the other team not to get a fast break on you.
Marquette will come back out here on the EMO, the extra man opportunity. Same six out there, Holden Patterson, Pierce Washburn, and Luke Blanc, plus the three starting attackmen. Jake Stegman back at X with a minute to go. Will Foster for Pierce Washburn. Ooh, that shot did not come out of his stick, right? But Marquette has the backup. There will be about 30 seconds or so remaining in the quarter when Drexel's penalty expires. Patrick Yudovich is in the box. Holden Patterson for Foster, now back to X. Marquette trying to get Drexel's defense moving a little bit.
That's right, and Drexel's doing a good job having their sticks up. They're staying home, protecting the middle.
They release the penalty, and we've got 15 seconds remaining. O'Grady comes over. He'll take the rock. Bobby O'Grady trying to go one-on-one against Grippo. An interesting opportunity there for O'Grady. Goes off the post. Drexel's there for the backup. 2 seconds. They'll fire one down. Time expires in the first half. And Marquette with an 8-6 lead after 30 minutes of action. They held Drexel scoreless for the first half of the second quarter. Drexel able to get two more, but Marquette maintains a two-goal lead after 30 minutes. Eric, quick thoughts before we head to break.
Yeah, both teams are executing their game plan. I'm excited for the second half.
Couldn't have said it any better myself. So we will have a halftime here before we come back for quarter number three between Marquette and Drexel. Make sure to stay tuned for what is bound to be a great second half.
We're different here. We don't just get up for another day. We rise. We don't just work. We endeavor. We're women and men, for and with others. We have hope. We believe. And we celebrate. Why are we different?
So we can be the difference.
Wide. Not much margin there.
roster continues to build, including Advocate Aurora Sportel, Meyer, Pepsi, and Town Bank. Town Bank is the official banking partner of Marquette University. Town Bank, home to Marquette checking with free ATMs nationwide. Meyer, from the biggest of games to the ones that mean the most to us, whenever you Meyer, you support hundreds of local sports teams across the Midwest. Meyer! Quick Trio Pez, hand-breaded, homemade fried chicken, homemade roasted whole chicken, and fried jumbo chicken tenders for lunch or dinner. Don't forget the sides, Quick Trip, we've got you covered. At Direct Supply, you're not an employee, you're an owner. Apply your passion for progress, talent for technology, and difference-making drive at directsupply.com/careers today. Coors Light is proud to support Marquette University Athletics. Enjoy Coors Light, mountain cold refreshment made to chill. Celebrate responsibly. Gruber Law Offices are proud to support Marquette University Athletics. Gruber Law, one call, that's all.
Welcome back to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, as Marquette men's lacrosse plays host to the Drexel Dragons here at Valley Fields. Dan Evington and Eric Simon here on the call. Eric, Marquette leading by two after 30 minutes of play. What have you seen so far out of the Golden Eagles?
Well, confident face-off and possession play and great shot placement so far.
Bobby O'Grady leading the way so far for the Golden Eagles with a hat trick. Three goals for the freshman out of Milton, Massachusetts, which you see here on the screen, a lefty rip there. A few goals on the man up today for Marquette. That one from O'Grady. This, a phenomenal effort with a low angle. Bobby O'Grady has been impressive so far this afternoon, but Drexel has also been able to tally some. Max Semple, a big shot from the outside. Not something he does all that often, but able to convert for the Dragons.
Yeah, they're just looking to gain a little more confidence, find a rhythm on offense, I think, and they'll be fine.
Janord as well, the most recent Drexel goal. But then Marquette able to get the last one before the end of the half as Chris Kirshner stung a corner for the Golden Eagles and makes their lead 8-6 after two quarters of play. We head back out for the faceoff. New man out there for Drexel, it's Aiden Shortley against Thomas Washington. They're going to throw whatever they can at Marquette this half.
Right, Drexel needs to win a faceoff.
Washington wins the clamp, sends it back, and Logan Crines picks up the GB. Marquette is on offense. Jack Farrell trying to hound Crines into a TO. And he does. Crines with not a terrible pass, but
it's hard to clear that 6-foot stick to make that pass. A simple one down the line.
Ooh, Will Foster the pickoff. Foster comes down, bouncer doesn't go. Save made by McGill. Run out is won by Bobby O'Grady. Whew. Up and down, up and down.
Yeah. The off-ball sticks continue to be vacuums, sucking up these passes, picking off passes.
Marquette now with 11 turnovers in the game. We were talking about that at halftime. Didn't seem like it was that bad ball security-wise, but you take a look at the numbers, and they doubled up Drexel in turnovers in half number one. But they've still got a two-goal advantage. And I guess when you have the ball so much after the face-off, you can afford a few extra turnovers.
That's right. They're taking care of the ball as best they can. The skip passes that get picked off, you know, you want to avoid that, but those are risks you take when you skip the pass.
O'Grady has his shot blocked. Now a ground ball being scrapped for. He gets pushed into the crease. And it's a crease violation, and somebody's down for Drexel on the defensive side of things. Looks like Drexel will send their trainer out there to investigate. And if that's a short stick, that's insult to injury already for Drexel, who's without multiple of their key SSDMs.
That's right. Both teams have really suffered a lot of injuries this season so far.
It's Peter Rahill who's coming off. Walking off on his own power, so that's a good sign for the Dragons. Luckily, they have their main short stick still out there. George Grippo, he's still healthy, but Brent McVicker, one of the top at his position in the country, especially only for being a sophomore. And now Drexel will look to facilitate a clear, but Marquette had that whole time to set up a ride. Mulcahy gets doubled. O'Grady attempts the wraparound. But Drexel successfully into the offensive zone. Mulcahy draws the long pole. Logan Crines against him, wraps around.
Off the pipe.
Chuck Dumas. Good box out of Corsell there to keep possession with his team. Semple open in front. Save made. Alieri. Aiden Call has his shot deterred. Almost an easy chance, but a great stick check from one of the Marquette defenders right there.
Yeah, two of them. Cracking down on the crease, not letting them get a clear shot off.
Here's Janord. Mulcahy working from behind the cage. Semple flashes. Dumas. Donnelly. A little bit of ball movement. Stephen Boyle's offense is at its best when the ball is hot. Haven't seen a ton of that today as that shot goes wide. Michael Alieri has the backup. Exactly what Coach Stimmel was talking about. That's the kind of goalie we recruited with Michael Alieri. He not only makes the saves, but he wins us extra possessions with his runouts.
Yeah, it's a game-changing opportunity right there because Drexel had a really good offensive set.
David LaMarca brings it over himself. Good communication there from Marquette to get two short sticks back on defense so LaMarca could take it himself. Aiden Miller sets a screen. And Luke Blanc has possession. Working on Maley. Blanc, pretty much a right-hand only player, as we've seen so far this year. Doesn't switch to his left all that often. Draws a slide from Yudovich. Coach Volker described as their physical defender. Aiden Miller. Bit of a speed dodge. Good move by Will Foster. The feed to Blanc. Hitch. Now over to Freeze. Freeze that shot. Saved. Yep, reset comes. So Marquette has a 60-second shot clock now. Some good chances there for the Golden Eagles. Ooh, big save from Drew McGill. Will Foster picks up the ground ball. Foster has been great on the ground balls today.
Yeah, nice hustle.
Hayden Miller almost mishandles that pass, but catches it on its way down.
Great job by the Marquette offense, attacking from all corners. They're definitely tiring out the Drexel defense.
Foster inside the bouncer. He got it. Even with a stick coming up high from Brendan Greenwald, Will Foster gets goal number two today.
Not a bad job by the Drexel defense, but after a minute playing D, they're just a step behind.
We'll take a look here on the screen. Foster comes around from X, working on Sean Quinn. Great ball security And he's able to beat Drew McGill from in tight.
That's right. The slide was a little late because they were spinning in circles there, so gave him an extra second here to get that shot off.
Foster has been a welcome surprise for this Marquette team. They didn't really expect to need him that much, but now he slots in an attack.
Yeah, he's bringing lots of intensity and hustle.
Important ground ball. No push. Drexel wanted one. They don't get it. And it's Marquette possession. T. Wash wins another one. That is 8 of 9 for Thomas Washington. A stellar performance from the redshirt junior out of Minnetonka, Minnesota.
And a great way to take control of this game because now Drexel's playing team defense again.
This year, Washington 60% entering today. And will only go up, of course. Ground ball after that shot was altered. And now Drexel might have a chance in transition. Grippo has a step on Washburn. The feed to Donnelly. Save made, Alieri. But the rebound is there for Aiden Call.
Wow.
Hold on.
He might have made two saves there. One laying on the ground. That second one was the ball's in his stick. He's in the goal, but I think he made the save. He's still holding his stick up like, how can you call this a goal if I have it in my stick? Just an amazing effort by Alieri. I honestly think that the refs are confused by how acrobatic.
How he made the play.
Yeah.
Well, it's 9:52 up on the clock. It's either 9-6 or 9-7, depending on the referee deliberation here. And they're going to call it a goal.
Watch as Alieri falls into the goal before making the second save. This one, great low stop there. He's in the goal a little bit, and he stops it, but his stick is behind the plane of the pipes.
That's a tough, tough break for the redshirt freshman. And it's 9-7 now. Drexel gets one back. Ball did cross the plane.
But really great effort by Alieri.
What are they going to call here? Two faceoff men were tied up.
They reface it.
Sticks were stuck together. All right, do-over.
Right, so it's not a hold if you're not physically holding back the player. If it's just the stick stuck together, then you really can't call a hold there. Good call by their officials.
And Thomas Washington gets this one. Tough break for Drexel, who had made it a 50-50 ground ball before the reface-off. Blanc heads onto the field with Griffin Freeze controlling possession. Now to Foster. Maley defending. Foster, nobody on him. Stegman in front. Ball is popped loose. And Stegman was pushed into the crease.
It was a good look. The feed was a little off the mark. It was tough for him to handle.
So Marquette has possession and 60 on the clock. Shot clock, that is. 9-7 up on the scoreboard. Scoring has slowed down significantly since that first quarter. It was 6-4 after 15 minutes. 9-7.
That's
here,
right. That's
almost
right.
Midway through quarter number three.
Yeah, and now, more than ever, possession time is going to be important.
Foster for Blanc. Has a short stick matchup. Blanc putting his body into Maley. O'Grady at X comes around. And a save made, I believe, and Sean Curcio wins the run out.
Yeah, good effort to to run out that shot. Marquette didn't quite have the backup they were looking for.
Marquette setting up the ride as Greenwald switches fields. Udovich for a short stick. Oh, ball's loose. And it's Marquette possession. Now Krein's in some trouble, gets out of it. Krein's phenomenal stick skills for a long stick.
That's right. Marquette's doing a great job with the 50-50 ground balls in the open midfield area. They really want the ball, they want possession, and it shows.
Jake Stegman, Udovich guarding him, switches. Washburn, a big shot, ooh, rings the bar. Oh, Verlinde, able to goose that ball back to his teammate. Oh, and then
that's a tough pass to make. When both people are streaming down the field, you make that pass across, tough to catch.
A little bit too hot.
Mm-hmm.
Out of the cross of Pierce Washburn.
Nice work by the Marquette ride so far.
Moe Lardy almost had an interception there. And Drexel with 7 more seconds to facilitate the clear. Wow, I don't know how. Yeah, that had to be offsides.
He telegraphed it, right? As soon as he stepped over, he knew he didn't have backup.
He pump faked and then stepped over anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Couldn't stop himself.
Yeah.
Not sure what took the referee so long to blow the whistle.
And real credit to Marquette's ride. They're sloughing off a little bit. They're letting them get it out of the box, but they're not letting him get it over midfield.
Foster working on the physical Udovich.
And if you're Drexel's defense right now, you've got to be huffing and puffing. Been playing a lot of defense in the last 2 minutes.
Probably could have been a ward against Pierce Washburn there, but no call as his arm came up and under
mm-hmm.
his defender. Freeze. Kirshner has it. The righty rip. Chris Kirshner goes top shelf. Ooh, that was a laser.
Right. And that's how open he was as a product of how much hard work the Marquette offense did throughout the last couple minutes.
We had a great angle on that one. Saw it all the way through as Kirshner stings another one. That was a pretty, pretty shot that Drew McGill was unable to come up with. And McGill has just been peppered today. 10 saves, but he's allowed 10 goals.
Yeah. And they varied the shot placement. That was high to high.
Washington got sent to the turf, but his team still has the ball. Krein's inside. Bouncer save made. Now another push. Whistle comes. And it'll be Marquette possession. Probably could have been a push earlier.
Uh-huh.
Andrew Stimmel pumping up the sideline. The belated birthday boy.
Yeah, a win here would be a great belated birthday present for him.
Against the Drexel team that went to the NCAAs last year. Gave your alma mater a bit of a run.
That's right. And, you know, you really see how much pressure you can put on a team when you hold on to the ball. They've had possession now for the last 3 minutes. I'm sure if you're on the Drexel defense, you are exhausted.
Hayden Miller tries to go to the cage. He got warded off by Ronan Peary, sophomore out of New York. 20 seconds up on the shot clock. Marquette leads 10-7. Dan Abington, Eric Simon here on the call of Marquette and Drexel. O'Grady has to go. Ball is jarred loose. Ground ball. Shot clock will expire on Marquette here. And a quick restart from George Grippo. Marquette's defensive personnel not out there yet. Drexel's O guy is not on either.
Right, and Drexel's just happy to get a clear. They'll take their time here, give their defense a rest.
Plotz, Mulcahy, and Genord out there, along with Semple, Donnelly and Call. Aiden Call, the most recent goal scorer for his team. Marquette, multiple goals from O'Grady, Foster, and Kirshner today, plus one from Miller, Stegman, and Blanc. Drexel with two from Genord and Semple, along with Aiden Call, and they get another one. Drexel goes a bit earlier in the shot clock than we've seen so far today, and it's 10-8.
Yeah, well, you can tell they're anxious to get a shot, and really great stick work by number five.
That's Jack Mulcahy, who we talked about in the open. A fake. That's a tough play to make. Made David LaMarca miss, and made Noah Verlinde miss as well. And it's a two-goal deficit.
He's got a great stick, and he's very shifty, very, very hard to track.
Mulcahy, preseason All-CAA, second-team All-Conference selection last year out of Chester Springs, Pennsylvania. CAA's assist leader this year, as Thomas Washington falls out of bounds. Won the faceoff, but Drexel gets the possession.
They still have to clear here. Should have a pretty easy go of it.
Almost a turnover on the pass there from Udovich. But Genord able to pick it up. Showing those hockey abilities with the quick hands. 3:35 on the game clock. Quarter number three. 10-8 Marquette leads, but Drexel trying to build on some momentum. Mulcahy with the most recent goal. He's out there along with Genord and Plotz. First midfield line. Tristan Plotz working on Hallam. Hallam, the heavy pressure. Genord. Good slide comes from Noah Verlinde, Marquette's number two cover guy, without Zach Granger in the lineup. 10 on the shot clock. Okay, he has to go. Woodward comes. The shot blocked. Actually, save made. Reset. Another save, back up, is Alieri.
The save and the backup, he does it all.
Michael Alieri, now with nine saves on the day, above 50% in this matchup. He is gaining more and more confidence as the year goes along. Just a redshirt freshman, but Eric, you were saying earlier, he does not play that way.
No, he's the confident. He inspires confidence in his whole defense.
Still learning how to be a more vocal leader, but when you win those runouts, you don't have to be as vocal.
Yeah, he leads by example. But you saw him, he was pretty pumped up after that too, so he's getting there vocally.
Here's Griffin Fries, back to Stegman. Foster hitches, the ball is on the carpet.
Good job by the Drexel defense.
Now they will clear. Greenwald finds a safety valve in Mulcahy, who carries across. Marquette has Fries and Kirshner both on defense. And now Kirshner gets off. Fries remains on.
It seems Mulcahy has a bit of a sense of urgency on offense, but the rest of the Drexel offense is, whoop.
Oh, Alieri. Great saves save. One right in front. Quick restart here for Aiden Call. Verlinde able to recover. Whew, on the doorstep.
Yeah.
And Michael Alieri stuffs him. Save number 10 today is Sean Donnelly. Almost made this a one-goal game again. Just over a minute remaining in the third frame. Errant pass. Goose back over the line. Foster's without his stick.
He's got to run off the field. You're not allowed to play without a stick. So if you can't get to your stick, you got to get off the field.
20 seconds on the shot clock. Feed inside. That one barely made it to the stick of Semple before it was back in the twine.
Yeah. a really great, there are two really great Drexel looks there. Team goal opportunities, and they capitalized on one.
10-9. Dragons are staying in it. You can see the feed here from Mulcahy. Nobody close enough to Semple. That one didn't even get all the way into the pocket of his stick before he put it into the goal. There's some of that Canadian flair.
Mm-hmm. It's a nice one-touch goal.
First lockup that we've really seen today.
Yeah.
Washington wins it back. Still scrapping for the ground ball. Bobby O'Grady approaching the corner. Ooh. Flag comes. I don't know who's going to draw the flag.
That's right. There were a couple hits there. One, that last one looked like it might have been from behind. Let's see what the referees have to say.
Looks like both teams committed a hit from behind. Mark Hartman, the one on that faceoff for Drexel. And unnecessary roughness against Mason Woodward. We'll take a look here. Bobby O'Grady got pushed to the ground.
Tangled up.
Woodward, it looks like the shoulder caught him up high.
Uh-huh.
But then Woodward caught a stick to the back as well, so I thought that
right
may have been called. But Drexel has the opportunity here to even up the game, or they could simply run out the clock and avoid a face-off to start the fourth quarter.
Yeah.
And it looks like that may be what they're going to do.
Mm-hmm. They've got plenty of time on this penalty.
It's a minute-long unsportsmanlike conduct against Mason Woodward.
They want to have a good opportunity in the next period.
So Drexel makes this a one-goal game after three quarters. It's 10-9. Marquette leads, but the Dragons right back in it. This one is anybody's game heading into the final 15 minutes of action. We'll have no face-off to start the fourth quarter when we come back.
We're different here. We don't just get up for another day. We rise. We don't just work. We endeavor. We're women and men, for and with others. We have hope. We believe, and we celebrate. Why are we different?
So we can be the difference.
Call 414-288 Go with you to book your group experience today.
Marquette Athletics 15 minutes to go here at Valley Fields. Marquette had all the momentum for a little while, but Drexel gets two back to make this a 10-9 game after 45 minutes. Dan Abington and Eric Simon here on the call from the Dome at Valley Fields. Eric, Drexel finally started to get back into this game thanks to some crafty offense there at the end of the third quarter.
Yeah, they got in a rhythm, and they were passing the ball really well, seeing each other really well, and they've upped the intensity a little bit as well.
Molson Coors is proud to support Marquette University Athletics. Enjoy Coors Light, mountain cold refreshment made to chill. Celebrate responsibly. So 10-9 Marquette leads here as we'll take a look at some of these Drexel goals. First, Mulcahy with the crafty move on the crease. We talked about him in the open as one of the most important players on this Drexel offense. And here, he doesn't get the goal, but he initiates the offense. Feeds one across to Max Semple. And Semple able to give his team a 10-9 deficit. And plus, their man up to start out this fourth quarter. They can even up this ball game.
Yep, they're going to have 44 seconds on the penalty. They ended the last quarter with possession, so they'll start with possession. There'll be no faceoff, which is a boon for Drexel, given their performance in that realm today.
Drexel has won 5 of 22 faceoffs today. They've also failed 4 clears in this contest. And now they will start on offense. James Amorosana, Marquette's man down specialist today.
Good ball movement by Drexel.
Curcio at the point. Donnelly. Augustine working around the crease. Curcio. Donnelly. Amorosana gets his stick on it. That'll tick off a few seconds. 10 remaining on the penalty to Mason Woodward.
That's that risky skip pass we were talking about. Both defenses doing a good job of breaking those up today.
Penalty has released. Aaron Joseph makes his way in. 15 on the shot clock. Marquette kills the penalty, back to even strength. Inside, and this is going to be a shot clock violation against the Drexel Dragons.
So Michael Olieri scooped that ball, it went out of bounds. He thought it was a shot, I think. The ref gave it back to Drexel.
I don't think he had it before the clock finished up.
And you're right.
They're putting 1 second
back on the
shot clock. Pretty much useless at this point, but
right.
Drexel will have the 1 second. And they're just going to toss this ball to the other side. Semple was trying to go in front of the net to maybe get some kind of trickery going. But with only 1 second, there was
not much he can do.
Oh, and an errant pass from Michael Olieri. Drexel has the ball right back. After all that defense, Marquette is right back to it. And they're going zone. Hopefully can help out some tired legs.
You'll see them set up in the, you know, packing the inside, so they're making Drexel take an outside shot.
Oh, Logan Crines gets his stick on that one. Hallam picks up the ground ball, swims, and now Marquette has a man advantage. David LaMarca coming down. LaMarca, feet inside. O'Grady can't clean it up. And somebody's in the crease. Back the other way we go.
Lots of transition.
Good move by Drexel there to take LaMarca and make him feed it. Easy clear. And Drexel's back on offense. Zone again. Here's Chuck Dumas.
Drexel doing a lot of good things on offense. The skip pass seems to be the thing that makes them fail too often so far.
10-9 is our score. Mulcahy to Dumas. The flip to Donnelly. Woodward on him. Dumas. First, that was Janord. And the save was made by Michael Olieri. Not an easy save to make either, coming across his body. But Olieri bails out the defense. Another pass to the sideline goes too far from Olieri.
A similar one, he's a little too excited.
And the ball is turned right back over.
Drexel tried to push it there, made another errant pass. The middle of the field has been the challenge so far in this quarter.
Olieri kicking himself over there, but his team has the ball either way. Aaron Joseph stays out there on offense. Now he'll come off. Washburn. Shakes his man, shoots off the pipe. Will Foster tries to come again. And it looks like Washburn's going to need to come off after he took, I don't know if it was a hit or a check or what, to the ribs.
Yeah, it might just be got the wind knocked out of him.
Took a hit to the head last week and remained out for a while as a precaution. Hayden Miller takes his place on the field. And Luke Blanc, who almost lost the ball. This has been some sloppy lacrosse here, Eric.
That's right. Yeah, the attention to detail has gone away a little bit. Maybe the teams are tired, but both still hustling like crazy.
Luke Blanc maintaining possession. Marquette going to bleed this down as much as they can. Looking for a quality opportunity. Kirshner back at X to Foster. Will Foster dodging, switches to his right. The shot, bouncer doesn't go, and that will do it for the shot clock. It'll be a violation against Marquette. They are going to get their defense on, though.
We'll have 1 second.
Krzyzewski, Corsell, and Moe Lardy, the three defensive midfielders who come on. Lardy with the 6-foot pole. McGill passes one to Greenwald. Now the pass to the other side. Sean Quinn has to come over and get it. 5 seconds on the clear. They're just going to fire this down. Semple picks up the ground ball. Not always the easiest way to clear it, but yeah, sometimes it works. Ooh. Semple almost out of bounds again. Nearly another turnover, but Drexel still has possession, despite some of their best efforts.
Yeah, that's right.
9 minutes, 35 seconds to go. Donnelly inside. Pass doesn't get there. It was tipped. Corsell tried to kick it out to some space, but Drexel maintains.
20 seconds on the shot clock here.
Augustine. Dumas hounded by Woodward. Dumas again on the outside, feeds one, and the pass does not get to Mulcahy. Marquette's defense does it again.
Good job clogging up the inside, making them pass around the outside. They couldn't find anything, any good opportunities.
Marquette has played a lot of D this quarter. LaMarca goes over. They're going to apply as much pressure as they can to David LaMarca here, and Marquette will take a timeout as LaMarca tumbles down to the turf. Great timeout call there from Stimmel, with his long pole having already overstayed his welcome on the offensive end.
Yeah, they definitely need a reset here. This is a great timeout. Just take a breath and get settled.
At Direct Supply, you're not an employee, you're an owner. Apply your passion for progress, talent for technology, and difference-making drive at directsupply.com/careers today. Town Bank is the official banking partner of Marquette University and home to Marquette Checking, with free ATMs nationwide. Start saving with Quick Rewards. Stop by any Quick Trip store and pick up your free Quick Rewards card, or download the free Quick Rewards app today. Marquette's still leading in most statistical categories here. 40 shots compared to 26 for Drexel. 35 ground balls compared to 20. Marquette 14 of 17 on clears. Drexel 18 of 22. Marquette winning 17 of 22 faceoffs. 19 turnovers for the Golden Eagles, though. And Drexel has one more cause turnover. Marquette multiple goals today from O'Grady, who has a hat trick. Chris Kirshner with two. Will Foster also with two. Hayden Miller, Jake Stegman, and Luke Blanc all have one. Four Marquette players with an assist in this game as well. Drexel, on the other hand, Janord, Cole, each with two goals, while Max Semple leads the way with a hat trick. Mulcahy and Donnelly each have a tally. Mulcahy has two assists in addition to that, and three other players with a helper in this game. Saves, Drew McGill has 12, and Michael Allieri has 11 for the Golden Eagles. Chris Kirshner will initiate the offense, working on Charlie Maley. 45 on the shot clock. Both offenses have seemingly run dry in this quarter. Either that or the defenses have really strapped in.
Yeah, definitely a credit to both defenses. Even in the first half, it was just the offense playing amazingly to get all those goals.
Foster jars a ball loose. Still loose. O'Grady gets taken down. A hold. And it'll be Marquette ball. O'Grady's getting up a little slow. Noah Verlinde helps him up. Basically picked him up and put him on his feet.
And got him and got back onside. It's a good teammate.
Marquette going to try to bleed some clock here and get a quality opportunity. Under 8 minutes to go. Will Foster. Took Quinn's ankles for a second there, but he recovers.
If you're Marquette's offense, you want to get back to what worked in the first half. That's attacking from all corners.
Ooh, Stegman, a nice opportunity. Doesn't go.
Keeping the pressure on, keeping your eyes up, and keeping the ball moving.
Here's Bobby O'Grady. Got his man hung up. Brennan Greenwald standing behind his goaltender. O'Grady comes inside. Shot saved. Reset. And Jake Stegman will take as long as he needs to pick up that ground ball. Clock's not moving on the scoreboard. Stegman. Now for Kirshner. Kirshner comes around, and that shot barely misses. Drexel wanted a ward call. Volker called for a timeout maybe seven times there, and it's finally granted. 6:54 up on the clock after it didn't run for a few seconds there. 10-9 is our score. Marquette leads. We haven't had a goal all quarter from the Golden Eagles, at least. And Drexel still right in this game.
Right, you mentioned the statistical advantage that Marquette had, but Drexel came back big time in the third quarter. They collected about eight ground balls. So those are eight opportunities they had to play offense where they were really lacking that in the first half.
Last Marquette goal was scored with 6:13 to go in the third period. Drexel's last goal, 35 seconds remaining in that third quarter, came from Max Semple. So both of these teams on a major dry spell after we started this game with 10 goals in the first 15 minutes. It was 8-6 at halftime, 10-9 after three, and with 6:54 to go in this game, it remains 10-9.
Yeah, and a credit to both defensive units. They're doing their job disrupting the offenses, picking off passes out of the air, making some great stick checks too, putting the ball on the ground. So really well-fought battle so far.
Marquette's defense clearly still the same unit. Mason Woodward, David LaMarca, and Noah Verlinde. Verlinde has played up top this year, but after the injury to Zach Granger, he had to slot in down low. A spectacular left-handed defenseman who has really stepped in, been disruptive. LaMarca, the third defender for Marquette, he's had a crazy good stick this year. And Mason Woodward, the headliner, probably an All-American candidate.
For sure. And both defensive units stepping out, pressuring out, making the offenses take outside shots.
Here's Pierce Washburn going left, shoots, it's high. Good opportunity, though, for Washburn. He's burned teams on that before, on Saturday, most recently. Kirshner draws a slide. Somebody's open. Washburn again. Look to go righty. Now Jack Farrell on him. Stegman, 10 on the shot clock. Stegman looking to feed. Now he'll have to initiate. And it'll be a shot clock violation by Marquette. Not sure if Stegman didn't know of the situation or if Marquette was trying to run it down as much as they could there.
Yeah, from where he was standing on the field, he didn't have a good look at the shot clock for sure. The sideline was trying to communicate it.
Under 6 minutes, and Drexel has another opportunity. They still haven't entirely figured out the zone, so Marquette's going to stick with it.
That's right. They've had some success shooting from the outside up top, but have failed to get to the next level where they're making those team passes and a one-touch goal. Maybe one or two of those, but not a lot.
Call. Here's Janord working on Corsell. Now for Semple. Krein's pressed out. Now moves back into position. Janord to X. Here's Mulcahy. LaMarcus hung up. Marquette's been comfortable with that today, though. Mulcahy leans in, draws a slide. 16 on the shot clock. Mulcahy across. Bouncer doesn't go. It's going to go to the corner. 10 seconds on the shot clock. 11, actually. Spoke too soon.
Mm-hmm. Got to get a quick one here if you're Drexel.
Plotz to Donnelly. Back to Plotz. Semple inside. Scores! Max Semple ties this ball game. Marquette defensive coordinator Jake Richard not happy.
Yeah, he might only have one hand, but he is magical with the stick handling in that one hand, streaking across the center of the field here.
Defense worked for so long. They thought they were getting a shot clock violation against the Dragons, and instead, Max Semple tallies the first goal of this quarter and ties the game at 10. Drexel has battled back from down three. Washington locked up with Hartman, and Drexel gets the ground ball. Never mind, Cole Sprinkle loses it.
That was kind of a dangerous pass back there.
Not even sure if he was trying to pass it or if he simply lost.
Yeah.
But Marquette on offense. Trying for their first tally of this quarter. Kirshner. Trying to go on Curcio. The right-handed shot. It'll be a reset after, I think, a save.
Wow, that came off the pipe and almost hit a fan. 60 yards away. What a shot. Lots of pace.
Under 4 minutes as Washburn moves it to Foster. Foster will kill a little clock. Working on Udovich. Foster tried to switch hands. Drexel's defense scrambling a bit. Now they're back in order. Freeze draws a slide from Greenwald to X. Here's Stegman. Jake Stegman. Short stick matchup on him. Washburn loses possession. Foster can't get the ground ball. Still loose. Nobody has it yet. Now Drexel does. Quinn with the shovel pass. Drexel in transition. Semple. Oh, man. Almost a one-handed goal from Max Semple.
Yeah, he wanted to score there big time. Really nice transition opportunity for Drexel. Both sidelines are into it now.
Been a while since Drexel had the lead in this game. Last time, 4-3. Last time the Dragons had an advantage.
That's right, and it seems like it's been a bit since they had a settled offense as well.
Here's Mulcahy at X. Krines shoves him off his line.
They got 25 on the shot clock.
Marquette in a man defense now. with a slide ready to go. Crines trying to body Mulcahy away. Ground ball in front of the crease. It pops out, and David LaMarca has it. 2 minutes to go in this game. Marquette will try to clear and maintain on offense. Somebody's got to come get the ball from Mason Woodward. And Chris Kirshner does just that. Kirshner trying to initiate early. Marquette can run this clock down pretty low. 60, yeah. Just under 60 on the shot clock, and it's 140 on the game clock.
But as we know from Marquette, they're going to try to slow it down, but they'll take any opportunity that they think is a good one.
Stegman fires high, back up to Drexel. Sean Quinn had a singular step on Kirshner.
Did a good job anticipating that shot, too.
Mulcahy to Greenwald. And Tristan Plotz carries one over. Minute and 10 seconds to go in this game. Stansfield. Moe Lardy trying to create a turnover. And the timeout comes from Coach Velker and the Drexel Dragons.
An important possession here.
10-10 is our score with exactly a minute on the clock. 53 seconds on the shot clock, 60 seconds on the game clock. Eric, if you're Coach Volker here, what kind of play are you drawing up?
Well, I mean, it seems like Max Semple, they're looking to him in the center. He can handle in pressure, and he can finish really well. So maybe you try to look to feed to him. You got number five, who's been amazing all game, all season. I think you look to get those two involved for sure.
Okay, he has mainly been back at X so far today, distributing for this offense a little bit. Semple with four goals. He's their do-it-all guy. After not playing in the first game, he has been utterly stellar since then, the redshirt freshman from Coquitlam.
And he looks confident on offense, but he's also hustling to get ground balls, picking things out of the air. So he's really been influential in a lot of places.
6 foot redshirt freshman. Brother played at Denver and was a 2021 draft pick in the NLL. Now 14 goals on the year in 5 starts from Max Semple. Humongous possession here for the Marquette defense and the Drexel offense. Marquette's personnel, it's Mason Woodward, Noah Verlinde, and David LaMarca, with Aaron Joseph, Anthony Corsell, and Logan Crines. To counter, Drexel goes with Donnelly, Call, and Semple, plus their first midfield line, Tristan Plotz, Jack Mulcahy, and Ryan Janord. Corsell seemingly trying to shut off Janord.
They don't want to give him a chance to attack a short stick if they can.
Crines applies pressure. Here's Plotz. He has a short stick matchup in Aaron Joseph. Janord working on Corsell. Tries to switch directions. Corsell stays on him. Mulcahy.
15 on the shot clock.
Ball is loose. Donnelly shoots. Oh, it goes wide. Drexel thought that was a goal.
Yeah, I bet you he wants that one back.
7 seconds separate the shot clock and the game clock. Under 10 on the shot clock. Here's Semple working on LaMarca. Shot saved by Alieri. Alieri's going to chuck one down the field. It goes a bit too far.
Good idea. There's only 2 seconds left in the game clock.
Quinn sends one the other way, and we've got overtime.
So both of these defenses really showed up in the second half. We expected to see them in the first half. It was a scoring affair in the first half.
After 60 minutes of lacrosse, We are all even at 10-10. Just as we started, this game locked up. It's sudden death overtime. We'll have a face-off to start things out. Mason Woodward and Sean Quinn out there to decide which way the teams are going to go. But it's sudden death. Whoever scores first wins the game.
And at the beginning of the game, you would have given the advantage here, this face-off, to Marquette. But credit to Drexel. They've battled back. They've made a lot of these face-offs into 50-50 ground balls, and they won a good number.
This Marquette team in week one had an overtime game, a 3-OT matchup against Bellarmine, which Marquette won 9-8. Bobby O'Grady, the hero in that one, with the game winner. No overtime since then, and Drexel, no extra period games yet this year. They had a one-goal game against St. Joe's on Tuesday, which they won 18-17 in regulation. Team projected to win the Colonial Athletic Conference, and Marquette is sticking with them today, despite their two headliners on offense being out of commission.
Yeah, and it's all day it's been a game of possession, and I think Marquette won the first three quarters. Drexel battled back and won a lot of team ground balls in the fourth quarter, so we'll see who shows up here.
Marquette at the end of a four-game homestand. They'll travel to Robert Morris for a game on Saturday. Meanwhile, Drexel stays on the road, but not really, as they really only travel to Villanova, which is not too far from Drexel.
That's an easy away game for them.
That's for sure. And then they have Robert Morris later in the week, as Thomas Washington goes back out. He's 11 for 14 on faceoffs today. It looks like Mark Hartman will counter him. Hartman is 1 for 1 on his faceoffs today, and he has provided a lockup in that one try. Washington wins it for Marquette. Drexel thought Marquette went early. Woodward being hounded. No timeout call from Marquette. And it looks like they're just going to go.
Coach Stimmel trusts his long poles handling in the middle of the field.
I figured they'd take a timeout to draw up a play.
Yeah.
Normally see a timeout after a face-off win. O'Grady loses the ball, gets it back, and now Stimmel wants a timeout.
You're right.
3:30 on the clock.
I think in that situation, you don't disallow your offense to get a quick opportunity. Marquette's always attacking, always dangerous. But then when the ball goes down in the field, now is a great time to take a timeout.
So 3 minutes and 30 seconds on the clock. Marquette and Drexel tied up at 10-10. Dan Abington and Eric Simon here on the broadcast. Glad you could join us here on this Saturday afternoon. Marquette with the offensive possession coming out of the timeout. Eric, Marquette has had a lot of offensive options today.
Yeah.
Who do you think they're going to try to get the rock to in this situation?
I mean, I'm sure they're trying to get it to O'Grady if they can. But more importantly, they're trying to have a good team offensive set, get the ball popping around the outside, get some good cuts on the crease, good looks on the crease. I think that's more important than finding any one person.
It's a Marquette team that prides itself on its offensive options. A hat trick for Bobby O'Grady. He's the team's leading scorer this year. Will Foster and Chris Kirshner, each with two tallies today as well, plus contributions from multiple other players.
Right, everyone's stepping up for Marquette, and they all have a ton of energy. So I think it's about, you know, working as a team here to get a good opportunity.
Drexel out there. Jack Farrell, the LSM. Charlie Maley and George Grippo, the two short sticks. Patrick Yudovich, Brennan Greenwald, and Sean Quinn, the defenseman. And Drew McGill between the pipes. Marquette's going with exactly who you'd expect. O'Grady, Stegman, and Foster, plus that first midfield line in Washburn, Fries, and Kirshner. O'Grady will initiate from behind the cage. Sean Quinn marking him. O'Grady comes around. Now for Washburn.
There's plenty of time on the shot clock.
Griffin Fries with a shot that goes high. not a bad chance.
That's that kind of surprising opportunity, right? They take one when you least expect it.
Ooh, a tough pass to handle for O'Grady, but he's got it. Trying to tangle up Greenwald in the back of the net. Foster shot. Looks like it went off somebody's head. And it's Marquette ball. I heard a loud clack.
We've heard a lot of shot deflections today between helmets and pipes.
Here's Jake Stegman against Maley. Stegman switches directions. Now again, he's looking to the front. Foster dodging on Yudovich.
5 seconds on the shot clock.
Stegman for Foster, and they're just going to toss it to the corner.
They've had some success rioting against Drexel's clear, so look for them to disrupt in the middle of the field if they can.
So Drexel will first try to clear and then get into a settled offensive set. Here's Maley. Foster lays a hit, and it's loose. 3 seconds. They get it over. LaMarca gets the ground ball. Corsell, Crines, and it's over. Whew. Logan Crines to end it. He can't. Ball almost trickles into the net, and Drexel will try to go the other way. Crines tried a long pole goal to finish it. And now Drexel has the offensive possession we were waiting for.
Nice grace under fire by both teams in transition there.
Thoughts on that shot?
It's a risky one, but like Marquette, you can't stifle them. They're always trying to change it up. They're always trying to catch the defense off guard.
Can't change your identity just because it's overtime.
That's right.
Mulcahy has his defender hung up. Jack Mulcahy looking for cutters. Coming around. Ball's loose. Anthony Corsell ground ball. Alieri to LaMarca. A minute to play. Marquette has it over. Corsell and Aaron Joseph should be getting off as soon as they can here. Give Marquette their offense. 40 seconds. Shot clock could basically be unplugged. Washburn now comes out. Same unit as before. Griffin Fries. Marquette going to waste the clock down.
That's right, they got 20 now.
Freeze, moving left, tries to get it across. It's picked off by Greenwald. The check comes, ball is loose. And Relindy picks off the pass. We'll go to double.
The defenses are stepping up on both sides here, for sure.
Some unique opportunities there in overtime that you don't necessarily expect to see. And not really the offense that Marquette's run today. But hey, it almost worked a few times for the Golden Eagles. Just can't find the back of the net. We're set for another 4-minute overtime period. We'll have a face-off again. Still the same rules, sudden death. First team to score wins the game. And right now, neither offense is really clicking. The defenses, despite probably being exhausted at this point in the game, have been stellar as of late. The Drexel defense hasn't allowed a goal since the third quarter, and Marquette has only allowed one since that point.
Yeah, and nothing really, you know, that we can point to individually that the offenses are doing wrong. I think they're just a little tight, a little nervous maybe, and like you said, maybe a little tired.
A Drexel team that scored 18 goals on Tuesday and gave up 17, now locked in a 10-10 game against Marquette, a team that has built its foundation on the defensive side of the ball. They think that they can be a single-digit goal defense every game. And, well, they're not necessarily single digits today. They're about as close as you can get to single digits,
yeah.
10.
Yeah. And credit to both the defensive units. I can't remember a game I've seen more passes picked off in the air than today. So, you know, they got their eyes up. They got their sticks up. They're doing a good job as a team.
Teams will go the other way now. Marquette left to right. Marquette white jerseys. Drexel in the all-navy. Here on a Saturday afternoon, Marquette's spring break. And it's packed here inside Valley Fields over on the opposite side. Thomas Washington and Mark Hartman again. Washington trying to pick up the ground ball himself. He can't. Gets it out. And Logan Crines will pick it up. Another faceoff win for Thomas Washington and the Marquette Golden Eagles. That's a 13-for-16 day at the X for Thomas Washington. And the Golden Eagles take a timeout.
And that's that timeout right as soon as you get possession, like you were talking about last time. No margin for error here. They want to take a breath, sketch up a play.
3 minutes, 47 seconds on the clock. Marquette will try to draw something up here for the offense after T-Wash did his job. Marquette team that's without Devin Cowan and Russell Melendez and without Nolan Rappas as well, who performed quite admirably in their stead. Bobby O'Grady has been the star of this Marquette offense, but they've gotten contributions out of the midfield, and Will Foster as well, a surprisingly impactful freshman for this Marquette team. Haven't seen Jake Stegman do all that much today. Had 6 points against Drexel last time, only a goal to his name today.
Yeah, and you've got contributions from a half dozen Marquette offensive players, so this is really about the team here.
The same guys out there for Drexel as I detailed earlier. Three defensemen plus Farrell, Grippo, and Maley. And to no surprise, the first midfield line out for Marquette. O'Grady will start with the ball in his cross. We'll take a look at what Coach Stimmel drew up in the huddle. The head coach, also the offensive coordinator for this team. Kirshner feeds one across. Freeze, save made.
Another big bounce off that save.
Drew McGill, the red shirt freshman. Now Sean Quinn coming the other way. It's poked loose. Semple wins it. Max Semple in transition gets goal number 5 today and wins this one.
There to clean up the garbage after a really nice trail check on a fast break. Max Semple is quite a player.
The Drexel defense straps in. Sean Quinn comes the other way, the ball's loose. Semple able to beat Alieri low. And Drexel emerges victorious after an extra period here. Eric, quick thoughts before we wrap this one up.
Well, really unlucky for the Marquette defense, right? They made the hustle and the trail check, and it just came out and bounced Drexel's way. But so fantastic job by both defenses all day.
Griffin Freeze almost caused the big turnover there, but the hustle play is all for naught as the Golden Eagles fall to the Drexel Dragons by a score of 11-10 in double overtime. A great effort from the Golden Eagles against an NCAA team a year ago. So signing off here from Valley Fields, for my partner Eric Simon and the rest of our crew, I'm Dan Abington saying thanks for tuning in and have a great night.